Right now we're going to have a look at the new features inside of Photoshop 24.6. This is the actual shipping version of Photoshop, not the beta. Because so much attention's been on generative fill, we haven't really talked a lot about the new features that are in the regular Photoshop. So these actually came out a few weeks ago. Let's look at the main ones right now. First feature we're going to look at today is the adjustment presets. If you go into the adjustments, you'll see we've got this new adjustments preset. Now you have to have an image open in order for this to be populated. If we click more, we'll see different categories. And we can actually just roll over these and see how they're going to affect the image. And at any time we can apply them by simply clicking. So what it does is it creates adjustment layers, which of course you can select at any time and look in the properties panel, and you can change any of these settings. Now the question people are going to ask is, can you create your own? And the answer to that is, sort of. Because I've actually got two hacks where you can save your own presets, which you could have actually done outside of this feature. But we'll get to that in just a moment. So let me just drag this adjustments out so we can have a look at it a little bit easier and see all the different options. So you can see we've got different categories here. You know, it's kind of nice with black and white and different ones. But one of the things you're going to notice as you click, it keeps adding more and more on here. So they're not really stackable, but they sort of are. Let's have a look. Let's open up the layers. So I've got all these different ones there. So I'm going to give you a little tip. Hold down the control key, that would be command on Mac, and click this little arrow. This will collapse all of them, and then you can just drag through the eyes. Great. So now we're able to turn off all of those presets, and we can look at them one at a time. And if we want, we can apply them. So it's kind of a fast way of auditioning them all. And at any point, we can twirl these open, we can look at the settings, and we can adjust these ourselves. And just kind of fine tune them to be what we want them to be. In order for these to be truly useful, let me show you how to create your own. Let's grab a hue saturation. I'm going to hit colorize and we'll give it some kind of a hue. Now I'm going to take the opacity down a little bit so we're blending it in with the original image. Let's create another adjustment layer. Let's create another adjustment layer and we're going to give it a little bit of contrast in curves and maybe drop that opacity down. How can I make this reusable? I have two ways. We're going to do it really quick though. So select both of those and hit Control G for group. And why don't we name this faded? All right, so we can see there's the adjustment on and off. Now there's two ways of saving it. One is to save it as a LUT. Choose File, Export, Color lookup tables. Let's save it as a 3DL in a cube. Click OK. And we'll call this faded. And I'll just save this onto my desktop. Click save. Now, if we wanted to apply this, we can go into the adjustment layer, choose color lookup, where it says 3DL, click again. There's our faded. Click open. Boom, it applies it. The advantages of this method is this doesn't just work in Photoshop, it also works in Premiere Pro, After Effects, other applications. The downside of this is you can't adjust all the parameters individually. Now there's ways around that. I did another video on LUTs. I'll link it somewhere where you can look at that. Method two, open the libraries. So remember we've created this group called Faded with our adjustments, and it could be as many as you want. Then we hit the plus button. Choose add all. Now watch this. If I throw away this faded, we're done, right? Under the group here, double click faded, and this is going to open this group inside of a new document. Just drag from here, release on the image, and now it works. And of course, this is fully editable. And if you're getting any value out of this video, hit that subscribe button, turn on notifications, you won't miss any of my videos. This second feature is definitely my favorite. Let me show you some creative ways to use the new gradients. Now, if you've been using the Photoshop beta, you might have seen some of these before, but they are now part of the official shipping version of Photoshop. So we're going to create a new layer, and I want to apply something with some gradients. Now you can choose the classic gradient so it'll work like it always did, or you can choose gradient. I'm going to choose gradient. I'm going to use a linear gradient for this one. I'm going to click on it. why don't we select the foreground to transparent? Let's change the foreground color. I'm going to change it to a nice warm color. And then we're going to click to drag across this way. Now, let's change the blending mode of this from normal to... we could use something like an overlay or a soft light, you know, for different blending mode. But the nice thing about this is now these are fully editable. So you can move these around and position them. In the past, you would apply them once and you'd be stuck with them. Then we can adjust our opacity or do whatever we want on our image here. This is a composite I did with the violinist Taylor Davis. All right, let's change our foreground color to something like a light blue, for example. Let's grab the gradient again. Make sure we're doing the foreground transparent, and we can drag off the other side. Change the blending mode. Let's use a hard light on this and drop the opacity down. And of course, we can reposition this. And so we can use this for color grading, but there's other things we could do. Let's create a new layer. Let's grab a bright one. Let's grab a white. And let's grab our gradient. And this time we're going to change it to a radial gradient. And we can drag it out. And notice how we can create these light spots. And we can move them around. We could even go to something like a linear dodge mode. Let's make it a little smaller. Maybe a hard light looks better for that. But see how it gives us the ability to reposition this wherever we want on the image. Another way we can use these is with masks. So let's grab this image, and I'm just dragging into the tab of the second image to combine them. Control T or Command T for free transform, and let's just quickly scale this. So we want to create a smooth blend between the two layers. So what we're going to do is create a layer mask. Choose the gradient. Grab a black to white gradient. Make sure it's linear. And now we can just drag across the image. And look at this. As we do this, we get this beautiful blend. And the nice thing about this, the previous one, you had to release it to see how it would look. On this one, we can just drag it until we're happy with the result. And of course, we can change the start point as well. We can also change the midpoint so it blends a little bit better. And of course, anytime in the future when we come back, we can select that mask, grab the gradient tool, and it's still fully editable. The next feature, I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about it because I've already done tutorials on it, and that's the remove tool, but I want to let you know that that is now inside the shipping version of Photoshop, no longer in the beta. But for those of you who don't know, and I'll give you the one big tip with the tool here, is what you want to do is create a new layer to use it. This way it'll be non-destructive. You're going to go down to the spot healing brush, and we're going to grab the remove tool. And then what we're going to do here is turn on sample all layers. Otherwise, nothing will work on that blank layer. And then we simply just paint over the area we want to remove. And AI does its magic. It's truly magical. But let's look at another feature which is not AI. Find a Go Under window to Contextual taskbar. And you might have seen this little taskbar floating around. So this toolbar will enable you to do things like select a subject. Then once that selection's active, you can do things like fill it with different things. You can apply adjustments. You can transform the selection, which, you know, we're not going to do on this image. You can inverse a selection. You can go into select a mask, and there's different things you can do with that. Another area it works is if you apply some text. It's going to pop up. You can choose the text you want directly from in here. Of course, you can click on here, go to the properties panel, and this will give you all the full adjustments. But let me give you the biggest tip of this, because sometimes it just pops up in the middle of your image and it can be really, really annoying. So what we can do is we can click on the three-dot menu, choose pin bar position. Now, when I put this, say, at the bottom, doesn't matter what I do, notice that that stays where it was. And notice the toolbar doesn't jump around anymore. So it can actually be really useful when it doesn't bounce around if you pin it down. So let me know in the comments, what was your favorite feature? And are there any of them you'd like to see me go more in depth in and create a dedicated tutorial? Let me know. And by the way, check out my other video where I show you the generative fill versus the remove tool that's right there. And if you're new, welcome to the cafe. Hit subscribe button, turn on notifications. You won't miss any of my videos. And until next time, I'll see you at the cafe.